All right. So welcome this evening to the mayoral debate between our mayor, Bill Carpenter, and the candidate for mayor, Chris MacMillan. To start the evening, we of course want to thank Lincoln Congregational Church for allowing us to use this wonderful chapel and edifice church. And we have the honor of having Reverend Houston Creighton open the evening in prayer. So introducing Reverend Houston Creighton to the Lincoln Congregational Church.
I'm so excited about your coming. I know you've been driving up and down Oak Street wondering what's going on with this building over the years, and it's so good to have you set foot in this place. I'm so elated right now. And as an old Army chaplain, I like to pray in my tradition, if you'll bow your heads. Gracious God, our Father, we thank you for this opportunity to come together as one people to work for the betterment of our brothers and sisters in this community. We truly want to be a city of champions, not in name only, but in action, Lord. We ask that somehow you'll get the glory out of this debate today, that we're all seeking the same thing, that all will be blessed in this city called Brockton. We thank you for those who have put this together. We thank you for the NAACP, for the work that they've done for over a century. We thank you for the leader of this great group. We thank you for the mayor and the candidate that's opposing him today, that somehow we will come together and that you'll be glorified and the city will be blessed. We give you all the glory and the praise in Jesus Christ, my Lord's name, I pray. Let's say amen.
Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is with great pleasure that I introduce to you the challenger, or the candidate for the office of the mayor of the city of Brockton, Christopher MacMillan. And it is, of course, with great honor and privilege that I have the opportunity to now introduce you to the current mayor of the city of Brockton, Mr. William Carpenter. This evening, we'll be operating through a format that I prefer to call a modified debate, a modified format of debate. We hope that the voters are able to differentiate the candidates pertaining to their style of leadership, philosophy of government, and plan for the city of Brockton. The rules for the debate are as follows. I will present a proposition, a statement to be considered. There may be a short narrative along with the statement. The first candidate will be asked to respond in the affirmative to the statement, to cite examples to strengthen his affirmative construct. And he will have 5 to 8 minutes. Our timekeeper will remind at 5 minutes to wind down or conclude your constructive statement. Then the other candidate will have an opportunity, which will last approximately 3.5 minutes, to examine, challenge, rebut, or negate the affirmative statement. The first candidate will then have 3.5 minutes to reaffirm his position. The next proposition will then be affirmed by the other candidate until we finish the questioning. And it is scheduled to last for 1 hour. As a form of icebreaker, we'll begin by posing this proposition and give each a chance to answer either in the affirmative or the negative, and also an opportunity to speak a little bit about their campaign. You will only have 3 minutes for this construct and comment. So the first proposition is this. In a democracy, voting should be compulsory. In a democracy, voting should be compulsory. The city of Brockton, per census, has a population of just greater than 94,000 people. Brockton has 45,772 active voters and 4,280 inactive voters, for a total of 50,052 total of active and inactive voters as of last evening. In 2009 general election, 28% of our voters came out to vote. In 2011, only 15% of our voters came out to vote. In 2013, 32%, and in our preliminary election, 20% came out to vote. So, Mr. MacMillan, I would like you to affirm or negate the proposition that in a democracy, voting should be compulsory. State reasons also for your position.
Well, in a democracy, I negate that it's going to be mandatory. Everyone has the right to vote here in the United States. This is why we built this country. This is what this country is built on. To force someone to vote is not a democracy. So everyone here should be out there voting, but you have the right to vote, or you have the right in the United States not to. It's your choice. We as candidates hope you come out and vote. That's what democracy is built on. It's all about that. But it's everyone's right also to say they don't like any candidate, they don't want to go out and vote. That's their choice. This is all about choice here, ladies and gentlemen. So my feeling is you should go out and vote if you feel passionate about this city. Now, we're going out right now knocking on doors, and everyone wants this city to be a better place. Both candidates, we both want the city to be a better place. We have two different ideas on how to get there. That's why we have opposition here. So to say that you have voting mandatory, it's not a democracy. It's definitely not. This is not Russia. This is definitely not North Korea. This is the United States of America. Everyone has a right to vote, or not. Your choice.
Mayor Carpenter.
Well, I guess first of all, I would also like to extend my thanks to Pastor Creighton, the members of the church, for hosting this debate here this evening, and to the NAACP and Mr. Bernard for agreeing to moderate. And both the Lincoln Congregational Church and the NAACP are both organizations with a rich history going back over 100 years in this city. So I think this is a very appropriate place for us to have a forum. In terms of the statement, I don't think I want to live in a place where people are voting who are being made to vote. I don't think that's the answer. But clearly, we need to do a better job of involving the residents of the city and getting them involved in the election so that they want to come out to vote and they want to make a difference in our city. During my time on the school committee, I advocated for more civics lessons in the high school, particularly in the middle schools, because I think in this world of MCAS, we've lost some of the good lessons we're supposed to be teaching our kids. I know when I was growing up, we had all kinds of civics and government lessons, so you learned in school all about this stuff. I think nowadays, we're graduating kids out of the high school that are never really being given the basics in civics, so how are we going to get them interested and involved when we didn't even teach them how the system works? So I think we've got some work to do there. In terms of our campaign and this question, I think if you look at our campaign 2 years ago, I think that was an example of getting new people involved and getting more people involved in the city. I was a non-traditional candidate. I didn't serve on the city council. I wasn't the mayor. And I didn't have any institutional support. 2 years ago, not one city councilor endorsed me for mayor. So So the way we won that election is we reached out to people that had not normally or previously been involved. And we got them involved, and we showed them that they could make a difference. And I think that's what we need to expand upon, is the outreach piece. And during my first 22 months as mayor, I've tried to bring that same approach to city government, filling positions on boards and commissions, reaching out to people. We've got a ton of talented, top-notch people here in the city who are not involved in helping out city government right now because they've never been asked. And what I've tried to do over the last 22 months is start asking those people and bringing in all different kinds of people to represent, to take offices on various city boards and commissions, representing all the communities within the city. But most importantly, bringing new people in, not just recycling the same old people over and over and over. So I think our campaign has shown that we can outreach and get new people involved. I think our first 22 months as mayor has shown that there are a lot of people here in the city who want to be involved. All we have to do is ask them.
That was the easy one.
Yeah.
And now the debate begins. The first question, or the first statement made, and the mayor, Mayor Carpenter, will be asked to speak on the affirmative. The first statement or proposition is, under the Brockton Charter, we operate as a strong council, weak mayor form of government. The definition of weak mayor, a mayor in a mayor-council method of municipal government whose powers of policymaking and administration are by charter in large degree subordinate to the council. Now I'm going to read that again. The definition of weak mayor, a mayor in a mayor-council method of municipal government whose powers of policymaking and administration are by charter in large degree subordinate to the council. Further, however, the mayor who is elected by the voters, the mayor-council variant, may be broken down into two variations, depending upon the relationship between the legislative and the executive branches, becoming a weak mayor or a strong mayor variant, based on the powers of the office. Mr. Mayor, please speak to the affirmative of the Brockton's weak mayor, strong council form of government, and how you work within the charter to affect positive outcomes. Cite examples of success or failure in cases where mayor-council variant was imposed. Mr. Mayor.
Okay. First of all, I think we need charter reform, and I'm hopeful that in the new city council that convenes in January, that there will be councilors that will take the leadership to begin a charter reform process, because we need to look at the entire charter, not just the model. I don't think it's appropriate for me as the city mayor to be the person involved in that, because I would be directly affected, but I do think we need to have the council initiate a charter reform process, which is a little time-consuming and very thorough, but I think there are a number of changes necessary in the charter. I would suggest from my experience of the last 22 months that we go to a four-year term for mayor, because 2 years is just not enough time to get the results from things that you've implemented when after 16 or 18 months in office, you're already back out on the campaign trail to run for re-election if you want to continue to serve. So I would hope that looking at a four-year term for mayor would be part of an overall charter reform. In terms of the strong council, weak mayor, that's a phrase I've heard a few times, usually at city council meetings. I think that it's, that phrase is really overstated and misunderstood. Yes, in the Plan B form of government, it is a stronger city council. But the mayor is still the mayor, and the roles are still clearly defined. The city council is legislative body. It's just like if this were a corporation, it would be the CEO and the board of directors. Where from where I come from on the school committee prior to serving as mayor, it's the superintendent of schools and the school committee. So the school committee sets policies, oversees the budget, and controls the checkbook. The superintendent can't write a check without the school committee signing it. And that's essentially the same model that we have on the city side of government. The city council is a legislative body. They can set policy by passing and changing existing ordinances, and they do control the checkbook, and that's what makes them strong. I have to send up a request for an appropriation to the council, and the council has to, a majority of the council has to approve the appropriation before the money is spent. I think it's important to have that system of checks and balances. But I think that sometimes people, when they misuse this phrase, strong council, weak mayor, it's just as compared to some other models of government. The mayor is still the mayor. The mayor is the CEO of the city. The mayor runs the city on a day-to-day basis. The mayor makes the decisions on a day-to-day basis. In essence, it's the mayor's job to keep the trains running on time, to keep the public safe, to make good decisions, and to show leadership. And I think I've tried to do all of those things as the mayor. And so, in terms of the language in the charter, I don't think it changes a whole lot. We do need to take a real hard look at that charter. But the city council's job revolves around reviewing the budget, approving appropriations. The city council does hold the purse strings, the checkbook. However, the mayor is the CEO of the city. It's not the city council's job to try to interfere in the day-to-day operation of city government. That's not their role. Their role is to set policy, to oversee the budget, and to approve, or to consider to approve, the appropriations that I send up to the council. And I think that's a good set of checks and balances. During my first 22 months as mayor, I think I've missed maybe two FinCon meetings, whether I'm invited or not. I am always available at every FinCon meeting to answer any question from any city councilor. I wish sometimes they'd call me on the phone with the question ahead of time, and I could just give them the answer instead of staging it for television, but that's a whole nother.
Mr. Mayor, sticking with the question and intervening to ask if there have been examples where you have used the variation that we talk about here, strong mayor variation, in order to fulfill some of your objectives as the mayor.
Absolutely. Just at the last FinCon meeting, I went to the city council and asked them to allow me to spend some more money to hire extra police officers, and we were able to have a strong show of support from the city council for that initiative. You know, in my first couple months as mayor, there were some well-publicized disagreements, differences of opinion between councilors and myself. You know, I think that passed after the first 2 or 3 months, and I think that since that time, and I own some ownership for that. I was brand new as a mayor, and there is some learning to do on this job. But I also think that cooperation is a two-way street. But I think that with time, I've worked very hard to develop positive relationships with the councilors. I've done everything I can to improve communications with the councilors. And I think if you look back over the past year and a half, there have been very few instances where the council and I have not been able to work together. And I think what the public doesn't always see is some of the private conversations that go on in between meetings, where I do listen to councilors and I do take input.
1 minute.
Well, I think I answered.
Very good. The other candidate, in this case, Christopher MacMillan, now has an opportunity to challenge, examine, rebut, or negate the mayor's construct. And you have approximately 3.5 minutes.
Thank you. Well, basically, I was a city council for 8 years, and I've dealt with a couple of mayors during my term. We are there for the residents of the city of Brockton. We're all elected officials, whether you're a mayor of the city council or councilor at large. School committee, so be it. This first term in here, his first thing he did, the mayor here, that he sued the city council because he didn't like the way the process worked. And right, the process, the way it worked, was the city council president could put two residents on a water commission. The mayor didn't like the choice, so he sued the city council. That's not how you work it here in Brockton. We're supposed to be all together as one. We need to be together. As a city councilor, we're the legislative side. We set the policy, we set the ordinances, and so be it. We don't create the budget. The mayor and the chief financial officer creates the budget. The city council has a responsibility to go over the budget. We can only reduce the budget, but we cannot dictate where that reduced money goes. It goes back into the general fund, and the mayor and the CFO will sit there and decide where it goes. So it's working right now, but the problem I see right now is that the mayor, who claims that he's not going to be raising taxes, that was his last 2 years ago, has raised the taxes again for 2.5%. He's going ahead and spent $13 million, had the city council push for a $13 million bond, which after this election, and I can guarantee you, he's going to be seeking a 2.5% override. And he's also claimed that not to raise any taxes. The Water Commission asked for a 30% increase. He's the one that pushed it forward. 30% increase, ladies and gentlemen.
Stick with the proposition. So, weak mayor, strong council.
The strong council is supposed to be getting along with the mayor and put the legislator forward to make sure the mayor is doing his job. It's also the watchdog for your money. So if the mayor tries to spend the money, unfortunately, the council that's in there right now, they approved everything I just said last Monday or Tuesday, sorry. So I believe when I'm the mayor,
1 minute.
It's going to be a very different story. I'm going to get along with everyone. I'm going to make sure the city is prosperous. I'm going to make sure we're bringing good business to the city. We're going to create great jobs for everyone here. And we're not going to start dictating to the council what they're going to do, because that's not right. They are elected officials that you all elected. And the mayor is elected by you. If I become mayor, I'm working for you, period. For everyone here in the city of Brockton. That's why I put my name on the ballot. I put my name on the ballot because I care about the city. I deeply care about this city. But we all have to go get together and make the city a better place to live. Thank you.
The first candidate at this time has an opportunity to reaffirm his position, respond, rebut, and or reaffirm. 3.5 minutes.
Well, first of all, let me just have a conversation about the Plan B form of government. Because the dispute I had early on with the city council that was resolved was that under an ordinance that was created here in Brockton, the president of the city council appoints 3 of the 5 members to the water commission directly. However, the state charter that outlines the Plan B form of government is very clear on this. The state law says all appointments to city boards and commissions are made by the mayor subject to the confirmation of the council. And so this ordinance that's used to make these appointments to the water commission does an end run on the proper appointment process the way it's spelled out crystal clear in state law. And I tried to advocate for that. And when our law department said that the only way that we could challenge it would be to challenge it in court. But I certainly had plenty of conversations with counselors, and I think what the counselors will tell you is that the following week or so, I met with almost every single counselor individually. I talked about the issue. We kind of came to a meeting of the minds that this issue was not large enough for us to start out early in my term fighting over this, so I dropped it. I am 100% sure had I pursued the litigation, the city would have won with my position. The state law is clear, but rather than continue to fight over it, I chose to look at the bigger picture to not poison my relationship with the council, and I worked with the majority of the councilors to agree that I would step back and I would withdraw the court action, but I actually do believe I was right. On the second point, I think Chris is misleading the public on the water rates. The mayor does not city council is the sole determiner of water rates. They get a recommendation from the water commission, and they can choose to follow it, not follow it, or set something different. In fact, the water rate increase that was recently approved by the council was sponsored by Councillor DiNapoli. Okay, so it was sponsored by a city councilor, passed by the city council, and the mayor has no role in the setting of water rates. If you want to talk about budgets and taxes,
I'll
talk about that. That's my responsibility.
1 minute, Mr. Mayor.
But water rates are not the main, there's no role for the mayor in the setting of water rates. Water commission makes recommendations, council makes the decision, and that's how it works. And now there's a council decision based upon the recommendation of the water commission, sponsored by Councilor DiNapoli, with no role from the mayor's office whatsoever.
The next proposition. The next proposition, where Christopher MacMillan will speak to the affirmative, is on education. Public education in Massachusetts is mandatory. All students must have access to a full range of educational programs, a highly qualified education, highly qualified teachers, comparable services to other cities in the Commonwealth, extracurricular activities, privacy and access to records, inclusion, non-segregated services, parental involvement. This information is obtained from the Massachusetts Parents Information Research Center. As mayor of the city of Brockton and chairperson of the school committee, speak to the affirmative of the Brockton School Committee System's assurance of the Massachusetts public education mandate for all public children. Cite examples of priorities in your planning to benefit the children. You have 5 to 8 minutes for this construct.
Well, as a Brockton Public School graduate of 1982, I feel that the city has a great public school system, and we shouldn't change it. We shouldn't allow charter schools to come in, and that's what's trying to get that in right now. As a mayor, you are the chairman of the school committee. I feel we should have more outreach for the kids to do after-school sports, which just got re-implemented today, this year, but they missed it for a whole year. We didn't have after-school sports for the middle schools. We need to reach out to the kids and make sure they have something to do after school. When I become mayor, I want to open up a community center that we have tutoring available to all the children. Have services there for people, adults to go in to re-educate themselves and learn a different tool or a different job. So with these public schools, it's a necessity that we reach out and keep these kids busy. If they're not busy, there's a lot of crime going to happen, and they're going to get into trouble. They're going to go down the wrong road. So as a sitting mayor, it's your job for the public schools to increase the funding for them, which we haven't done, is to fight the state who has a formula, a monetary formula that is, quite honestly, pretty bogus for the residents of the city of Brockton, that we need to change that. I will go up to the State House personally with the superintendent of schools and fight to the bitter end that we get an adjustment to the formula so to bring more money back to the schools so we can hire those teachers that were all laid off this year. We have 30 to 35 kids at the high school per classroom. That's not education right there. That's babysitting at best. So these children, are in there right now and they're suffering. And quite honestly, it's not fair for them. It's not fair for the teachers. It's not fair for the paraprofessionals. It's not fair for anyone out there, and especially it's not fair for the administrator that's trying to do their job. So I feel that we should go up to the state and battle the state again. We've done it before, we sued the state, they changed the formula, we have to do it again. I know right now the superintendent has spoke with me, and she said she's up there right now trying to get that readjusted. And I believe the mayor's probably going up there with her, I hope. But the thing is, it's too late. He has 2 years. his tenure is almost over. I don't know where he was last year, but right now, it's an election year. It's all election year. Everything that's come around right now is political election year. It's a farce. You know, we have an election year policing right now. We have an election year needle take back.
School department.
Ladies and gentlemen, please don't get fooled again this time around. 2 years ago, you gave me a good idea.
Mayor Carpenter, you will have 3.5 minutes to challenge, examine, rebut, or negate the construct that Mr. MacMillan has put forth.
Sure. Well, for starters, I think that I have been a very strong advocate for the children in the city of Brockton. I and my children. Chapter 70 formula is broken. It does not recognize the additional cost that we have in a gateway city like Brockton. We have a large percentage of students who are English language learners. We commit additional resources for that. We have a large percentage of kids with special needs. We have a large percentage of kids who are living at or below the poverty line, and that causes extra challenges and creates extra challenges in education. You know, 80% of the students in the Brockton Public Schools qualify for a free or reduced lunch. 80%. So we have to spend more money to do the great job that we do, and the Chapter 70 formula does not recognize that. Chris mentioned the charter school. When the charter school was trying to come in last year, I was right out front with the superintendent and the school committee fighting that charter school proposal. I did not think it was good for the city. I thought it would siphon millions of dollars out of our public schools without allowing us to recoup those expenses. And I'm glad Chris is paying attention to what we're doing about the Chapter 70 formula, because the school committee, the superintendent, and I have been meeting for about 6 months now, planning another legal challenge to education funding in the state, and we're going to take a student from Brockton like we did before, cite the case, and sue the state to fix the formula and properly.
So, it'll cost me 30 seconds if you like.
And I will remind everyone that I'm only the second mayor in the history of the city to go directly from the school committee to the mayor's office. So I was already serving on that school committee for 4 years. When I became mayor and took over as chair, I hit the ground running. I already knew all the things we were working on, and I think I've been as or more involved in the schools than any other mayor. It's very important to me. It's the future of our city, and I fight for it.
Well, you have 3.5 minutes to reaffirm your position and to challenge, if you may.
Well, first of all, it's the school committee that brought that school sports back, not the mayor. The mayor wants to take credit for whatever he wants, but it's the school committee that put that money back in the budget. It's the school committee that put those kids back into sports. So, ladies and gentlemen, you know, I just tell you right now, this is politics 101. Don't go. Let's put your fingers on everybody and say, say it's my job to do this. I'm doing this because I'm the mayor and no one else is taking credit for it. You can't take credit for it. I'm sorry to tell you, the school department's doing a great job, the school committee's doing a great job, but we lost a lot of teachers, and we have to come up with the money to do that. The money was cut. The mayor cut some of the money also, but not that school spending. So that caused a lot of trouble with the custodians being laid off, the paraprofessionals being laid off, and this is something that we have to correct. So if I become mayor, this is definitely going to be education 101.
The next statement, resolution, proposition, as you will go to the affirmative position or construct from Mayor Carpenter. The power plant and the casino projects are needed in Brockton to significantly increase tax revenue and to provide sustainable jobs and income for many Brockton residents. The positives of having both power plant and the casino project completed far outweigh the perceived negatives. Please speak to the affirmative or the negative of this proposal or proposition or this statement. Cite examples to strengthen your opinion. Offer alternatives for Brockton jobs and tax revenue sources if speaking in the negative. Mr. Mayor.
I don't think I should count as one question. There's a lot to tell.
You have 5 minutes and up to 8 minutes to build your construct.
First of all, just for the record, I've increased the local contributions to the school budget by $9 million a year in my 2 years. And the casino proposals are two separate proposals and really require two separate discussions. In the case of the electric plant, I inherited an ongoing fiasco that had been going on for years. And the fact of the matter is, as the CEO of the city, I stepped into that situation, and I made it clear when I ran for mayor 2 years ago that I thought that the proper course of action would be to settle the litigation with the developers of the electric plant to protect the city from financial ruin if there were a settlement in the tens of millions of dollars against the city, and also to stop the bleeding of the reckless waste of money on legal fees continuing to fight that thing. We've spent well over $1.5 million on out-of-town lawyers to fight a case we can't win. And that was my feeling coming in. However, I think I surprised a few people because I did not rush to action. I did not settle that lawsuit until over a year after I became mayor because I took advantage of the time after I became mayor to make sure that I learned more about it, that I consulted with our attorneys both inside and out, that I went back and read the previous decision by Judge Sorokin, that I really thoughtfully and with an open mind, looked at the city's position. And when I completed that process, it was clear to me that to continue to waste the taxpayers' money in a fight you can't win was not in the best interest of the taxpayers of this city. And quite simply, to really boil it down, if you spend over $1.5 million hiring lawyers, you ought to listen to their advice. And what I did is I listened to their advice. In terms of the economic benefits that Steve referred to, in the settlement of the lawsuit, we negotiated an agreement above the industry standards. In the settlement of the lawsuit, the city of Brockton will receive $82.85 million over the next 20 years. $2.85 million up front, a guaranteed $4 million per year to the city of Brockton. Stop spending the millions and start collecting the millions because, as we discussed, we need this money for our budget, and everyone wants does not want their taxes raised. I don't want to raise them either. We have to develop these alternate sources of revenue to stop going in your pocket every time the cost of running government goes up. And that $4 million a year will go a long ways towards that. And we saw just the news this week that with the shutdown of Pilgrim, we're a shovel-ready project, there is immediate need for the electricity that that plant will generate. In terms of the casino, that initiative did come in under me. I didn't inherit that one. A proposal was brought to me to develop a casino at the site of the Brockton Fairgrounds. Again, I did not rush on it. I took our time, we looked at it, and identified what we thought were areas that needed to be improved in the proposal. We worked with the developer, but we were able to negotiate a host community agreement that's called for under the law. Under this host community agreement, the city is guaranteed $10 million per year to the city. In addition to that, we would collect rooms tax on the 225-room luxury hotel. We collect a piece of the meals tax in the 5 restaurants, and we sell water and sewer that we have available to sell. When you add in those things to the $10 million, it's really $12 million a year in revenue to the city of Brockton if the casino were to come to the fairgrounds and operate. And just last week, I negotiated the mitigation for, there's two mitigations called for in the casino law, the state law, and reaffirmed in the host community agreement. And that is to get extra reimbursement for the impact on traffic and extra reimbursement for the impact on public safety. And we settled that mitigation negotiation a couple weeks ago.
3 minutes.
It calls for $10.2 million worth of traffic infrastructure, road repairs and reconstruction and upgrades on the west side of the city. $10.2 million worth of traffic infrastructure, 100% paid for by the casino before the casino can open its doors. Those repairs are needed. I agree, we have a traffic issue on Belmont Street. But the traffic issue on Belmont Street is primarily rush hour, Monday through Friday, morning rush hour, evening rush hour, and about 15 to 20 minutes in the afternoon when the high school lets out. A casino, the traffic flow to a casino, it's not the football game. Everybody doesn't try to leave at once. Everyone doesn't show up at once. It's a flow of cars. And at the time that their flow of cars would be the highest, would be Friday nights and weekends, and that's when it would have the least amount of impact on traffic on Belmont Street. We have pedestrian safety issues in the city that I've worked hard on with the task force since last year. And that area around the Belmont West Street, Belmont coming up through the West Street section, that's identified as an area where we need to make pedestrian safety improvements, and this traffic infrastructure money will allow us to do that. And in terms of public safety, we negotiated an additional, over all of this other money, an additional $1 million per year for police and fire. That will hire 4 firefighters, 8 police officers, and additional school crossing guards with no cost to the
taxpayer. 15 seconds, please, to wrap it up.
I know how Mr. McMillan feels on both of these proposals. And my simple question to Chris would be, $4 million a year for the electric plant, $13 million a year from a proposed casino, $17 million a year that changes this city. And if you're going to block both of those projects, please explain to us specifically where you're going to raise $17 million a year.
At this time, ladies and gentlemen, thank you. Thank you. At this time, the other candidate, Mr. MacMillan, will have an opportunity to examine, challenge, rebut, or construct his argument.
Thank you. And thank you, Mayor, for including me in your little talk there. He's a professional speaker. He should be able to do this well. I am not a professional speaker. I'm a resident here of the former city council. So I'm here for the residents. But as far as the power plant goes, my ideas, my vision, to not have this power plant. The residents don't want it. But it's my vision is to expand the wastewater treatment plant, create a pellet plant just like they do with Quincy, and have it sold. The money that we can bring in is more than the power plant would be there. The power plant's going to be there. It's going to only hire six to ten people tops. It's going to have union jobs. Great. But if we expand the wastewater treatment plant, how many union jobs is that going to create for all that time? We had an upgrade of $86 million for the wastewater treatment plant. That's where I work for disclosure. I work for Veolia Water, and we run that plant. But this is something we have to look in the long-term vision. Where's plan B? This casino is all up to the state. Where's plan B? Plan B, if you're throwing all your eggs in one basket for this casino, which I'm strictly opposed to, but this casino, as they're saying, is going to hire 1,500 jobs, but you have to be qualified. If you have a blemish in your credit report or you have a blemish in your quarry, you're no longer qualified to apply. Ladies and gentlemen, they never said that before the voting took place, did they? I didn't hear it. I don't think you heard it either. But the thing is, I'd rather sit down with the owners of that property and create some type of business that goes in there, like a Faneuil Hall, with multiple restaurants and multiple stores in there, and we can enjoy the night. Create a destination place other than the casino, because that's all it's going to bring around that area is blight. It's going to bring pawn shops and prostitutes. I'll tell you right now. Not good for working together with the owner of those properties, that property, and bring in quality businesses for the city to be respectful and quality jobs for the residents here in Brockton. Thank you.
And Mr. Mayor, you have an opportunity now to reaffirm your position.
Well, first of all, we are looking at electric generation possibilities for the wastewater treatment plant, so I'm glad we both agree that that's a good idea, because we're looking at that. In terms of the casino and the jobs, 1,500 jobs, in that host community agreement, I negotiated a resident's preference in hiring. That means Brockton residents go to the front of the line for every single job at the casino.
As you applaud, you take away from the mayor's time to speak.
In addition, the jobs at casino, we've done our due diligence, 80% of their jobs require no previous training or experience. So that tells me Brockton residents should get about 1,200 of those 1,500 jobs. So good paying jobs with benefits. If the casino does not go in there, I believe we'll get a Walmart or something like that. Those are $10 an hour jobs. I want good jobs that with benefits that people can support their families on. Those are the types of jobs that are created. I also negotiated a local purchasing option because this casino, besides being the largest taxpayer and one of the largest employers, will be one of the largest customers in the region. So I also negotiated a Brockton preference on purchasing goods and services. So whenever the casino and its hotel and five restaurants, the whole complex, looks to purchase goods and services, they have to look to purchase those goods and services from Brockton companies first. And that will pour millions of dollars into the private sector economy of this city from that money being generated. So this will help our economy, create quality jobs that will improve the lives of over 1,000 families in our city. And in terms of the crime and prostitution, White Ward 7, Chris, you represented for 8 years. We've already got drug dealers and prostitution on North Main Street. I knew the one of the highest ones.
Proposition, ladies and gentlemen, the next proposition goes to Christopher MacMillan to speak to the affirmative or the negative. It is on the subject of health, community, and public safety. Rehabilitation should be valued above retribution in the United States criminal justice system. The abuse of illegal drugs should be treated as a matter of public health, not criminal justice. Please construct an affirmative position that these propositions are fitting, will lead to a healthier Brockton, stronger communities in Brockton, and a safer Brockton in the future. Christopher MacMillan.
You're talking about the opiate addictions right now, the epidemic. It's a nationwide epidemic, and we have to work diligently with the law enforcement and all the hospitals to stop this nonsense. We have to educate the children. We have to get into the schools early and make sure they know what's going on. But as far as public safety goes, you know, we just have to make sure, and Mr. Carpenter alluded that, yes, we have drugs here in my ward, my old former ward, because I was a counselor. We have drugs everywhere in the city of Brockton. Sorry about that, Mr. Mayor. You're supposed to clean this up. You were saying 3 years ago, you got to go to three corners in every block, every neighborhood, to clean this epidemic up. You haven't done anything. It's worse now than ever. So where is it? 2 years ago, it's election year. We talk about all this right now. Everything's coming around right now. We have a needle take-back program the mayor just put in initiated. It's all about politics. It's all about the election year campaigning. So this is what we're doing again. Nothing happened the first year. He was in a big learning curve. So everything comes out right now. Quite honestly, what a coincidence. We have 9 officers coming out at the end of this month, 3 days before the election. Come on.
Rehabilitation or retribution.
And they had notification when he first took office that they needed 9 officers right away. He waited till the end of that year, figuring out it takes about 1 year to have these people chosen and go for a 24-week academy. Now he's got another 6 going into the academy. He's trying to expand it to 11, I believe. I just saw her on the agenda. Politics as usual, ladies and gentlemen. It's election year, law enforcement, just as the mayor accused the former mayor of doing 2 years ago. Everything's happening right now because it's an election year. They put the Tower of Doom up right now in Lincoln Parkway, which I call the Tower of Doom, the police extension there. It's for nothing. It's people driving into Brockton, they're scared. They see that tower up there, they're saying, what is going on? It's a high crime area, I'm getting out of here. It's not proactive policing. That's what we need, ladies and gentlemen. If I'm elected mayor, I'm going to be proactive, but allow the police officers to do their job and not micromanage them.
Thank you, Mr. McCullough. Mr. Carpenter, you still only have 3.5 minutes
to
challenge, examine, rebut, or reconstruct.
First of all, let's get the number right. I'm hiring 21.
Yes.
Let me remind both the mayor and the audience that the question or the proposition is rehabilitation should be valued above retribution in the United States criminal justice system. The abuse of illegal drugs should be treated as a matter of public health, not criminal justice.
Right. But you allowed him to wander on his answer. I gave him a rebuttal. So let me jump to the opiate crisis real quickly. I was advocating on this crisis long before I ever ran for public office. That's why I ran for public office. And I think that today as the mayor of Brockton, I'm recognized on a statewide level as being a leader in the fight against the opioid crisis. And earlier today at the State House, I stood alongside Governor Baker when he announced filing legislation based upon recommendations from the mayor, from the governor's opioid working group that I served on, and I worked on those recommendations. And the fact of the matter is that I am the only mayor that the governor has. You don't have to tell me how bad the opioid crisis is, because I get the call. We lost another person this afternoon. That's the third one in the last 4 days. That's why we're fighting this thing as hard as we are. But it is a game of supply and demand. And we are fighting to reduce the supply. We are going after drug dealers. In my first full year as mayor, we almost doubled the number of drug searches. We need money, we need manpower, we're investing in technology, we're also investing in boots on the ground. And to get back to the question, I was one of the strongest advocates for, to bring that drug court to the Brockton District Court. I fought for that for you. And drug use uses the threat of jail to get people into treatment. And under the governor's proposal today, medical professionals will now be able to hold someone for up to 72 hours if they determine that they could be a danger to themselves due to addiction. And the purpose of that is to give families and loved ones a chance to get into court and get a Section 35 and try to save these people's lives.
And the final proposition for the evening, ladies and gentlemen. The opportunity for the affirmative goes to Mayor Carpenter. In municipal government of Brockton, all departments in service to residents should have employed staff that reflects the diversity of the community. Department and services including police, fire, public works, to name a few, and City Hall point of service stations as well, where there is direct daily interaction with the public. I will repeat, in municipal government of Brockton, all departments in service to the residents should have an employed staff that reflects the diversity of the community. Department and services including police, fire, public works, to name a few, and City Hall point of service stations as well, where there is direct daily interaction with the public. Please speak to affirm that this proposition. How would you achieve the goal of diversity in the city government? Express the importance of diversity in the city of Brockton and especially in city government. Mr. Carpenter.
This is one of our priorities. And when we came into office 22 months ago, we're doing it. We have, you can just look around and see the difference. Let's start with the police. That class of nine officers coming out of the academy on October 30th, you know why there was a delay in getting them to the academy? Because last year I requested from civil service the ability to have a separate language list to hire a Korean Creole officers, two speaking officers, two of those, and two Haitian Creole speaking officers, and civil service denied that request. And I stood tall, I hung tough, I fought with them for 8 months until they finally.
You are taking away from the mayor's time to speak. Please be seated. You're taking away from the mayor's time to speak.
Two speak Haitian Creole, seven out of the nine are from the city's minority communities. It's the first minority-majority police class in the history.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm respectfully going to ask you to hold your applause because I do want to wrap up.
And I agree with the premise of the question. It starts with the police department because community policing, we're committed to community policing. That's part of the long-term answer. But if you're going to have effective community policing, you need to have police officers that reflect the community that they serve. And that's why I'm trying to do. But we are carrying that to all levels of city government. We have not been very many openings within City Hall, but we have hired a minority person in the elections department. We have hired a minority person in the personnel department. We just hired two IT professionals, not entry-level jobs, professionals, a network systems analyst, and an IT public safety tech. They're both men of Cape Verdean descent who live in this city. They were given an equal opportunity to compete for those jobs. They deserve those jobs, they earn those jobs, but we made sure that they had a level playing field so they could fairly compete. That's a new way of doing business here in this city. And even on the school side, I've lobbied hard with them to be more sensitive to this issue, and they are. They just hired 10 school custodians, 5 women, 5 minorities. They are also following the lead that I'm taking in City Hall by making sure that we are not just a city of opportunity, but a city of equal opportunity.
I'm going to add to this question for the benefit of both candidates. There are, and I will give you this time that I'm taking. Among the minority communities in Brockton, there is diversity in demographics. There are many minorities in Brockton. Where you emphasize only a couple so far, explain in your reasoning for diversifying city government,
sure,
how you will include more of the demographics of the city.
I thought I made it clear a couple of times when I said include all of the minority communities, all of the communities in the city. The specific example around civil service and police was to give us the ability, we would have to hire from the top of the list down. And we did, 5 positions from the top of the list down. However, to create opportunities for those 2 communities to be represented on the police department, we had to request and fight for those foreign language lists, or those 4 officers would have never made it high enough on the list to even be considered to be hired. And so that was using what I can within the confines of the Civil Service Commission and civil service law to address that inequity. And I'll stand behind 2 Haitian Americans on that class, because I took over a police department of 174 police officers, of which 2 speak Haitian Creole. We doubled that number to 4 now. It's still not enough. I listened to the police scanner. We do need multilingual police officers and first responders, because we're serving a city of multilingual people.
Well, we're at 5 minutes.
We're also going to see, to respond to the fact that you added on, in my appointments and hiring, it's equal opportunity. We're not lowering the bar for anybody. We're just making sure everybody has a fair chance. And in terms of my appointments to city boards and commissions, my final group of appointees I sent up about a month ago to the city council. I sent up 8 nominations to city boards and commissions, and all 8 were from all of the minority communities. Proactive on this issue and take it on even when it's not popular, and I've done that. I think actions speak louder than words. Take a look at what I've done over the last 22 months. Actions speak louder than words.
Mr. MacMillan, you have approximately 3.5 minutes to challenge, examine, rebut,
or
form of your own construct.
I think that we should have more in the City Hall itself. Of minorities, especially if I become mayor, I'm going to set up a kiosk with a person out there who speaks multiple languages that can help the people that come into City Hall, because quite honestly, when they walk into City Hall, when people walk into City Hall, they're roaming the halls, they have no idea what they're doing, they don't know where to go, they don't have anything, they want to see, where do I get my birth certificate, they don't talk to anyone, because there's no one out there to help them out. So we need to expand on this, and I agree that we have to expand it with the firefighters and the police officers to make it more of a diverse community the way we have it right now. Look at the crowd around, look at this crowd. It's a diverse crowd. This is great. I applaud everyone for being here tonight. This is what we need in the city. City workers need to be just like this format here, diverse. We don't want to be pitted against each other, have Cape Verdeans going against the Haitians or the Latinos going against someone. We're all one person here. We're all put on this earth to do the same thing, to raise our children in the same community, to raise our families where we feel safe. Ladies and gentlemen, I do agree we need to get more diversified
have, especially on the city council. I was a city council. When I was a city council, I had Jay Stewart, who's the only minority on it. Now we have Shane Bond, Voices of Rodriguez. Jason's leaving right now, but I hope that you, when you go out and vote, you diversify the city council. I applaud that. I applaud Pierre, Mr. Pierre from running. I applaud that. So that's what we need here in the city of Brockton. Although Mr. Pierre, sorry. But we need to have more diversity. It also has to be, the qualifications have to be put in place. You can't skip over people just because of the diversity, to make it diverse. So, ladies and gentlemen, we need to do a job as a community to work together. Whether you vote for either one of us, we have to, after November 3rd or January 1st, when hopefully one of the mayor, I need everyone's help. We need to work together as a team. Thank you.
And Mr. Carpenter, you have 3.5 minutes to reaffirm your position.
Well, Chris, I appreciate your comments. If you want to see real diversity, you ought to come to one of my campaign events, because every community is here.
Through this modified format of debate, I hope that you, the voters of the city of Brockton, have had an opportunity to differentiate the candidates pertaining to their style of leadership, their philosophy of governance, and their plan for the city of Brockton. We wish them both well. We wish you all well. We encourage you all to get out and vote. I want to thank the executive committee of the NAACP for allowing me to put on this program this evening. Particularly, we'd like to thank Reverend Creighton and the members of Lincoln Congregational Church for allowing us to use their church for the debate. And we pray the best for all citizens of Brockton, of the city of Brockton. Thank you very much for coming out tonight. Good night.